Welcome to Homes of Hope and Healing Evangelistic Campaign. We are thrilled that you are here. Here are a few guidelines to ensure an enjoyable stay with us. Parking is permitted on the compound. However, it is restricted to the perimeter of the yellow and white tent. Please follow the instructions of the parking attendant. Washroom facilities are also available for your convenience just outside the entrance of the compound. Children should not be permitted to go there alone. Should you desire tap water, there is one available near the fence at the entrance of the compound for your convenience. Do you have a medical emergency or are you feeling unwell? There is a health tent on site and there are health professionals waiting to serve you. Do not hesitate to reach out. Prayer is a constant need and it is provided freely throughout the duration of the program at the white tent behind the blue and white tent. Bring your prayer requests and have someone intercede on your behalf. Our prayer warriors are waiting. Parents and guardians, please note that children should not be left unattended, especially on the left sides of the tent near the water. Let us all remain vigilant to ensure the safety of all children. There should be no unauthorized removal of chairs from their places under the tent. I repeat, there should be no unauthorized movement of chairs from their places under the tent. And finally, enjoy the service. Tell someone, bring a friend at your next visit.
Guilty stain, the dying thief, rejoice to see the fountain in him stay.
Wash on my sins away.
Wash on my sins.
Wash on my sins away.
son.
Welcome to Homes of Hope and Healing Evangelistic Campaign. We are thrilled that you are here. Here are a few guidelines to ensure an enjoyable stay with us. Parking is permitted on the compound. However, it is restricted to the perimeter of the yellow and white tent. Please follow the instructions of the parking attendant. Washroom facilities are also available for your convenience just outside the entrance of the compound. Children should not be permitted to go there alone. Should you desire tap water, there is one available near the fence at the entrance of the compound for your convenience. Do you have a medical emergency or are you feeling unwell? There is a health tent on site and there are health professionals waiting to serve you. Do not hesitate to reach out. Prayer is a constant need and it is provided freely throughout the duration of the program at the white tent behind the blue and white tent. Bring your prayer requests and have someone intercede on your behalf. Our prayer warriors are waiting. Parents and guardians, please note that children should not be left unattended, especially on the left sides of the tent near the water. Let us all remain vigilant to ensure the safety of all children. There should be no unauthorized removal of chairs from the places under the tent. I repeat, there should be no unauthorized movement of chairs from the places under the tent. And finally, enjoy the service. Tell someone, bring a friend at your next visit.
running, I feel like skipping. Thank you, Jesus. Let's all stand as we do that number. Routine and grounded. In the name of the Lord.
Good night, everybody. You may have your seats. You may have your seats. We all look beautiful in our yellow tonight. Come on, we all look beautiful in our yellow tonight. It has been a long week, but God is good, amen? Come on, God is good. And all the time, body boy. What's the hell you sleeping, man? Body boy, tutala. You know, every time I come on this stage, I have to say it. Amen? So tonight, I'll be doing a short presentation to our youths about studying. Do I have the screen? Yes, I have the screen. Praise the Lord. I feel like pastor tonight. All right. So, how to study effectively. Now, just running through this. Now, everybody have their own type of studying. Some things may work for some people and some things may not work for some people. But it is up to us to know what works for us. Amen? We follow in. So some students, they are motivated easily. And some, they have to, you know, work a little harder. They have to get somebody else. Boy, my teacher teach me something, eh? Eccentric motivation. Everybody say eccentric. Come on, eccentric. My English teacher there, she know what I'm saying. And that means to get motivation from outside. All right, I see I have some students over there. We have motivation from outside. Whereas some students have eccentric motivation where they... Sister, same word. That is when you get motivation from yourself. All right, so we're moving on. Now find the best way to study in this process. And it is something that we should not do the night before the test. Plenty of our students, we fall for that. and we end up studying the night before. But praise God for people like me, just work. Hallelujah. But by God's grace, I'm encouraging you tonight, do not always study the night before the test. Because sometimes your brain tends to shut off in the test. And you might not remember what you studied the night before. Are you following me? Now learn some ways that will help you avoid panic attacks and frustration during the test. After all, you might most likely get a little less stress when you study before the night of the test. Amen? Now let me give you some tips quickly. Make a study schedule. Now some of us, we maybe not so strong in doing that. So we can ask our parents to help us make a schedule on what needs to be accomplished and the types of questions that we think that might be in the test the next day. Amen? Amen. Come on, you're sleeping, man. Amen? Amen? So what is our first thing? Make a schedule. The second one is make sure your notes are completed. Sometimes the teacher just give notes in the class and you might just scribble, rap, 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 and you check in, okay, yes. And then when it's time for you to study now, you're trying to wonder, but what I write there now? Some students only know what I'm talking about. Not true. I have some people over there. Yes. All right, so we're moving along. Every day, make sure to review your notes. It might be something that is a little difficult for us to do, but let us review our notes every day. Everybody say, every day, we shall review our notes. Come on, I have some students over there. Okay, moving on. Create a study area. And that is not our bed, brethren. That is not our bed. Because I have already fallen as a victim of sleeping while studying. Because I've been lying down on my bed. Oh. But I'm encouraging you and myself tonight to create a spot where you feel comfortable, but will not encourage you to be distracted or even fall asleep during studying. Now, everyone is different. So you have to find a spot in your house, on the porch, or in the backyard that might work for you. Amen? So we're finding a spot to study. Number 5, take breaks when you study. Now, some of us, we can go 5 hours straight studying. But brethren, that is not healthy for our brain. We need to take short 5-minute, 10-minute breaks so that our brain can have time, recuperate, and recharge for the next time we're going to study. Amen? Come on, all you sleeping on me, man. Amen? All right, we move into the last one. Stay far away from distractions. Now, when you go in and study, I have a little thing on my iPhone. You have to put it on Do Not Disturb. And everybody's phone have that. So I encourage you, your phone app Do Not Disturb. When you go to study, put it on Do Not Disturb. Or if when you're going to study, give your mother the phone. Tell her, hold that for me. When my time up, I'll come for it. Because sometimes, while you're studying, you might hear a little ping. Your petting maybe message you. You go in and watch your phone. Everybody know what I'm talking about. Everybody know what I'm talking about. So we can't get quiet under the tent tonight. Okay. So when you studying, stay far away from distractions. All right. Now the last step. And that is the most vital step. We need to ask Jesus for help. Because it's in our own power. We can't do it. We cannot do it. So there's a text in the Bible that says, we can do all things through that strengthens. Come on, we're sleeping, man. We can do all things through that strengthens us. Praise the Lord. English. Hallelujah. Now, we need to ask God for help. Because in our own human nature, brethren, we cannot do everything by ourselves. And it's only God that can pull us through this kind of heavy studying times. So students, and myself, and even parents, you can assist your children to create study times, to create a plan, to create a lesson area. A study place for them to know, all right, this is where I'm going to study and take my next 2 hours. And also stay far away from distractions and don't forget to pray before and pray after. I thank you for listening to this presentation. It has been well spent. Thank you.
Good night, everybody. Good night, everybody. Better.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. It is such a rewarding thing to give. And what better way to give than give to the work of the Lord? So at this moment, I invite you to search in your wallets, in your pockets, in your purses, and give generously to the cause of God as our ushers collect our offerings this evening. Join me as we pray. Merciful Father, thank you, dear Lord, for your love towards us. Thank you for the effort you have given us to work and our ability to give back. We pray that you will bless the offerings given and that you will help with the furtherance of your work here in Dominica. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
I need a blessing. Showers of blessing.
Blessing. Showers of blessing. Good night, everybody. And happy Sabbath to all of you. I heard you say amen, but I didn't hear you say happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath to all of you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'd like to shout out all of those watching us on the World Wide Web. Wherever you are watching us from in the world, we give God thanks and praise for you. And we trust and hope that you will enjoy the services online as much as we enjoy bringing them to you. I want to issue a special invitation to all of Dominica watching me on the World Wide Web. As long as you're on the island and you are alive on the brighter side of this Sabbath, I'm issuing a special invitation for all Dominicans watching us on the web to be with us under the tent tomorrow morning. It's extremely important that we get together to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. The Apostle Paul says, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together, as the manner of some is. Well, I like that old King James Version style English. But he's basically saying, let's associate. Let's get together with people of like faith. And let's not stay away from the brethren. It's crucial and critical that we have periods of fellowship and growth and maturity together. So I'm inviting you all to come down. Any member of the church who has prepared their child for baptism, please remember, the baptism happens immediately after the service tomorrow morning. So you've got to be here, and you've got to be here on time. We would not like to have a surprise of a person announcing at the last moment that they would like to be baptized. We would like our pastors to have a conversation with all of the candidates, our Bible workers or our elders to have a conversation with the candidates. And so we are asking persons to indicate tonight. There's a form online in the YouTube chat which the team will share with you right now. You can fill out that form indicating your desire to be baptized in the morning. And please put all the other information there. We will contact you. When you arrive tomorrow, please see one of our ministers, see one of our Bible workers, see one of our elders, so we can have a conversation before the baptism happens. Now, somebody said to me a few nights ago, Pastor, I want to be baptized. I mean to be baptized. But then they said to me, must I come up to the front? Must I come up on the platform and so on and so forth? I want to say to that person tonight and to others who might be thinking the same way, if you take a public stand for Jesus Christ, you are setting an example for somebody else to follow. And let me tell you what happens on the tents like these. There are persons looking to see if their friend will go forward, if their mother will go forward, if their brother or sister will come forward. And that for them would be the signal that they also should make the decision. Now, I would like you to stand up and be counted because somebody needs your example so that they can follow the decision that you're making. So please, every time we call, we would like you to come, not because we want to wear you out, but simply because standing up another time seals your own decision and allows other people to see also that you are very serious about what you are saying. Want to remind you, we begin at 9 a.m. in the morning. What time did I see everybody? Now, Seventh-day Adventists, bear that in mind. We start at 9 o'clock. I know you're accustomed to 9:15, but we start at 9 o'clock. And the later we come, the more it delays and pushes back the service, and then we have to leave late. Now, we don't want that. So let's come on time so we can get what we need to have done completed, and we can move forward and leave on time as well. Tomorrow afternoon at 3:45 p.m., there will be the talent program. Everyone who wants to participate, either by poetry or by, I understand, skits and dramas have been submitted as well. Or you want to sing solo or duet or quartet or group or choir. All of that is welcomed. But tonight is the last opportunity to give your name to Pastor Kadik Tittle. He's over here on my right-hand side. If you leave tonight without doing that, I am sorry, there will be no opportunity for you to participate tomorrow afternoon because we are closing off tonight. Is that clear to everybody? Right. So we'll have a matter of a concert of sorts tomorrow afternoon at 3:45. Let us stand at this point in time and sing our theme song. Where's Pastor Collier? Is he on the tent? I have that. Okay, thank you very much. the power of your love. Renewed. Flowing from the grace.
Flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I come to know
the weaknesses I see, in me. The power of your love.
Power of your love.
Come on, everybody, and sing the song. Hold me close.
Hold me close.
Let your love surround me. Bring me near and draw me to your side. As I wait,
and as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on by the power of your love.
Lord, unveil my eyes. Let me see you face to face. The knowledge of your love as you live in me. And Lord, renew my mind. Your will unfold.
As your will unfold in my life, in living every day.
By the power of
by
your love.
The power of your love.
Come on, everybody. Hold me close.
Hold me close. Let your love surround me.
Bring me near and draw me to your side. Heavenly Father, tonight we give you thanks and praise. This is a central, fundamental topic that we are going to address tonight. And every message from your word is important. But tonight we are asking for extra unction so that with clarity and power, the gospel concerning the Sabbath day will be presented tonight. Grant that all who hear may also be filled with the authority of the Spirit, not merely to hear, but to respond with obedience. This is our prayer and this is our asking in Jesus' precious name. Kindly be seated in the presence of the Lord. I notice some people are faithfully wearing their campaign colors. And others need to get with the program. Tonight is yellow night. Now don't rush out and buy a lot of clothing. I know I don't want to expense anybody. But remember we said, if you have a hair accessory, my sister is tapping it there, you know. All dressed in black, but she has the hair accessory. Notice I'm just here with a tie and so on. So whatever you have, you know, yellow shoes. Anybody has yellow shoes? Whatever you have, you know, get on board. Brother Goring, you're looking nice tonight. You have your yellow on. You ready to preach?
Oh, yes, preacher.
Now, this is a big one. This is a big one. We got to take our time with this one tonight.
For sure.
The topic tonight is ICY.
M-I.
M-I. What does that stand for, everybody?
In case you missed it.
In case you missed it. Now, I've been trying to keep up with the young people in the church. Because nowadays, they have been speaking another language. And that language comes from internet slang. It comes from the way they use abbreviations and so on the internet and on social media in particular. And I've been discovering more and more these slang expressions. And I've been trying to find a way to make them relevant within the context of my preaching. Because even though I'm going on in age, I still like to identify with the young people. I'm not done yet, Pastor Tittle. You know, I've been a youth pastor for most of my ministry. And I want to continue to try and keep up with the young people. Please slow down a little bit because I don't walk as fast as I used to before. ICYMI, in case you missed it.
Oh, yes.
Now, I looked at the online dictionaries and they told me that ICYMI stands for in case you missed it. Now, this expression is used on social media when a person wants to point another individual in the direction of something interesting or something enlightening that's available for that other person's perusal online. And so they send it off to the individual as an attachment. Send it off as a picture. Send it off as a link. And they say, in case you missed it. This is something important that you should see. ICYMI is often accompanied by information, an article or video that a person believes the recipient would appreciate, find interesting, or would educate that individual. ICYMI, I am told, is also used to remind people of important things. I'm sending this to you because perhaps you may not have seen it before. You may not have thought about it before. In case you missed it, here it is now. Sometimes people use ICYMI to mean, you may already know this, but I wanted to make sure you did because it is so important. In this way, they tell me online that ICYMI is a sort of mixture between FYI, for your information, and BTW, which means by the way. Now tonight, I want to use ICYMI to direct your attention towards some things which you may already know, but I don't want you to miss or overlook the importance of those points. ICYMI for me tonight also, in case you missed it, means that I am aware that some people are here tonight for the first time, or perhaps the second or third time.
and you have not had the benefit of hearing all that I've said from the first sermon. So tonight is a kind of a bouillon.
Tell us, preacher.
A repetition of some things that you may have missed, just in case you missed it. You'll be able to fill in the gaps. While adding new information, I will repeat some things that I said before. So are you ready, Brother Goring?
Oh, yes.
Let's begin at the beginning of the Bible. What does the Bible say happened when this earth first started? Genesis 1 and verse 1. Out loud, everybody, with the reader. Or we don't have it? Oh, I'm sorry. Do we have it now?
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the
earth.
You know,
all right, but I want them to see this is critical.
No, no problem.
So do we have it? Do we have it? Or what do I have to do? Pardon me? I think I've done that. Well, maybe somebody needs to rush up here and help me. But I think I'm extended. Go ahead. And you sat there all the time, didn't see and didn't say anything. And I'm going great guns. And you are just sitting there saying nothing. All right, so let's see what happens here now, right? I think that's it. Do we have it? Not yet. Let's try one more time. I'm going to plug out and plug back in. Yes. Okay, so we have it now. Good.
Hallelujah.
People may not know, but this pastor was an IT man before he was a pastor.
Silicon Valley, California?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So where was I? I said all this thing about ICMI, and now I'm ready for the bouillon.
Genesis.
Let's go.
Yes, sir.
So in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, what does the Bible say, everybody?
In the beginning,
God did what?
Created the heavens and the earth.
So this dispels the notion that we are somehow evolved from lower species. I told the church that God is the creator of all things upon the face of the earth. And as such, he has the right and the authority to tell us how we must live. Seventh-day Adventists believe that God created the heavens and the earth in 7 literal days. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 days. But the scripture tells us that whereas the first to the sixth day were ordinary means of creation, God did something extra with the seventh day. Can I get an amen out there?
Amen, preacher.
What does the Bible say in Genesis chapter 2, verse 1 to 3? Out loud, everybody with the reader, what does the Bible say?
Thus the heavens and the earth,
they were what?
Were finished.
And all the host of them, go ahead now.
And on the seventh day.
And on what day, everybody?
Seventh day.
Now wait a minute, on what day, everybody?
Seventh day.
The seventh day, what did God do?
Ended his work.
God ended his work, which he had made. And he did something else on the seventh day. Reader, what else did he do?
He rested.
On which day?
The seventh day.
So he ended his work on which day? And rested on which day?
The seventh
From
day.
All his work.
Yes, sir.
Which he had made. And God did something to the seventh day. And read it out loud, everybody. What did he do?
He blessed the seventh day.
And
sanctified it.
Why?
Because in it he had
rested
uh-huh. from all his work
which God had created
and made.
Now, wait a minute, church. In this passage, we see God creating the heavens and the earth and resting on which day?
The seventh day.
The seventh day. Because in that day, he ended all his work which he had created and made. And then the Bible says, God blessed the seventh day.
Oh, yes.
God sanctified the seventh day. Because in that day, he had rested from all his work. Does the scripture say that God blessed any other day?
No, sir.
Which day did the scripture say is God bless?
The seventh
day.
The
seventh day.
Yes, sir.
So the first six are ordinary, but the seventh day is special because God blessed, God sanctified, God rested from all the work which he had created and made. Now that sounds very similar to me to the commandment that is number four.
For sure.
So I want us to read that tonight. Exodus chapter 20, verse 8 to 11. This is the fourth commandment because the commandments are found in Exodus chapter 20. Let's read together, everybody, verse 8 to 11.
Remember.
Now stop. Yes. What's that first word, everybody?
Remember.
Now, why would God tell anybody to remember something? Why would anybody tell anybody else to remember something? Every now and then, my wife asks me to go to the grocery store to get something in particular for her. Now, I normally shop, as I told you before, I'm the cook, so I shop for the groceries. But there are items she may want. She may say to me, I need this or I need that, and I need 3, 4, 5 things. When you go to the grocery store, pick up those things for me. She will say, remember to bring the eggs. I'm just calling some items now. Remember to bring the margarine. Remember to bring the flour. But don't forget the milk.
Okay, preacher.
Now, when a person says something like that, it gives priority to a specific item in the list.
Definitely.
You are drawing attention to the fact that eggs, sugar, and flour are important. But whatever you do, do not come back without the milk.
True, preacher.
Are you listening to what I'm saying? Does that make sense to anybody?
Lots of sense, preacher.
Now, do not forget is the same thing as remember. Why would God say remember the Sabbath day? It is because it is the very day that most people forget. And another fact that we need to pause and ponder and think about tonight is that God says, remember the Sabbath day. And if he says, remember, it is likely that he told you before.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, preacher.
Is anybody hearing what I'm saying to you? So I'm making 2 points. Number one, don't forget this day. It is critical and important. And number two, I've told you before, remember. Now, I hope people are understanding me. I'm taking my time with this one tonight because it's a big one. What does the Bible say again in Exodus 20, verse 8 to 11? Remember what day?
The Sabbath day.
Now, in Genesis earlier on, in chapter 4, I believe it was, 1, sorry, God rested from all his work which he had made on which day? What does the earlier text say? On the seventh day, Genesis
yes,
chapter 2.
Oh, yes.
And now in Exodus chapter 20, the commandment says, remember the Sabbath day.
Yeah.
So it appears that the seventh day and the Sabbath day are one and the same.
Oh, yes.
Now let's read the commandment, Exodus 20. Remember the Sabbath day to do what?
Keep it holy.
And then it goes on. 6 days
you shall labor
and do all of your
work.
Now, where did we see this formula before? Doesn't this commandment look almost exactly like what God did when he first created the world? Don't we see the same words being repeated, the same pattern being repeated? God ended the work, the creation, and rested the seventh day, blessed it, sanctified it, because in it he had rested from all his work. And now the commandment comes thousands of years later and says, remember. Remember what? Remember that when God made heavens and earth, he rested on the seventh day. Remember that God blessed it. Remember that God sanctified it. Remember that God ended all his work on this day. And to remind you, the commandment repeats the same words. Keep the Sabbath holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. Remember what God did as an example for us. Let's continue with the verse. But which day?
The seventh day.
Which day, everybody?
The seventh day.
So the commandment now repeats what Genesis chapter 2 said God did. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of whom?
The Lord.
The Adventist Church.
The Lord.
Pastor Anthony Hall.
The Lord Preacher.
Dominica. The East Lord. Eastern Conference. It's my Sabbath.
Oh, no.
What does the Bible say the Sabbath is or whose it is? The Sabbath of the
Lord your God.
Why? It is he that blessed it. It is he that sanctified it.
Oh, yeah.
It is he that rested on the seventh day. The Sabbath is not an invention of the Adventist Church. It's God's Sabbath.
Hallelujah. Praise his name.
I want to make that clear. When I was growing up as a child, people used to say, 7 days, 7 days, they read their Bible upside down.
Mercy.
And the reason for that is because they could not understand why we were doing the things we were doing. And I told you before that the Old Testament and the New Testament, all scripture is good for doctrine, good for correction, good for reproof, good for instruction. And when we look to the Old Testament, we find out where the Sabbath began. It did not start with the commandments. It started when God rested.
Yes, preacher.
On the first Sabbath day.
Hallelujah.
Are we clear about that?
Christ.
So the commandment continues now. It is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it,
you shall do no work.
And why does God say you shouldn't work? Because when he rested, he didn't do any work.
True.
All right, let's go. You nor your
son,
nor your
daughter,
nor your
male servant,
nor your
female servant,
nor your cattle,
nor your stranger,
nor who is within your
gates.
Continue. For in 6 days,
the Lord made the heavens and the earth.
Where did we see this before? In Genesis chapter 2. So this is really a repetition of Genesis chapter 2.
Yes, sir.
And hence the reason why God says, remember, the commandment is not new.
True.
The Ten Commandments, when Moses received them, were not new. They were reminders.
For sure.
Of what God had already taught people. But people forgot. So God is now saying, remember, I would like to point out that there are 10 commandments in Exodus 20. But there's only one that begins with the word remember. And it's the very one that many modern preachers today have no regard for and have forgotten. I told you all up in here during the course of the week that there are preachers who are saying that the Ten Commandments have been abolished. But they don't really mean that. Because they will never endorse stealing or killing. Are you listening to what I'm saying?
True.
What they mean when they say that is that they don't like the seventh day Sabbath.
Mercy. Straight talk, preacher.
That's what they really mean. All the others are good. Don't covet. Don't steal. Don't lie. Don't kill. Don't commit adultery. But when it comes to the fourth one, that's Jewish. Did anybody hear me in here tonight?
Loud and clear.
Now, how can you pick up one out of the 10 and decide that that one is Jewish? I want to tell people up in here tonight that all of the commandments are for all people in humanity.
Amen.
Not just for the Jews. In the same way the health laws, don't eat pork, don't eat ducks, don't eat fish without fins or scales. That's not for the Jews. Somebody says that was a Jewish law. But I want to tell you tonight, don't you know what will kill a Jew will also kill you?
Oh, yes, preacher. Straight talk.
Are you all hearing me tonight? God said, don't eat hog meat because it's nasty.
Correct.
Don't eat shark because it's nasty.
That's it, preacher.
Don't eat fish or things in the water that do not have fins and scales. Because fins and scales are the fish's mechanism to keep extra salt outside of their bodies. And fish that don't have fins and scales retain urine in their flesh in order to balance the salt content with the water. When you eat these creatures, you are eating filth.
Yes, sir.
Essentially, what the Bible is saying is stay away from animals that are scavengers.
Correct.
Things like rats.
Come on.
Things like mice.
Manicou, preacher.
Manicou?
Oh, yes. A bigger rat, preacher.
Without a tail?
Manicou.
It has a tail? I don't know anything about it. Agouti? Uh-huh. How the agouti lost his tail? But let me tell you something in here tonight. God is clear in his word that the principles of health
that
I just described to you are not Jewish requirements. They affect the well-being and the health of human beings.
Yes, sir.
And doctors are telling people more and more today, leave out the flesh foods.
True.
Why are we waiting for the doctor to tell us that? When God has already said that these things are not the best diet. When God gave a diet to man, he said every herb yielding seed upon the face of the earth in which there is a seed in the fruit, that shall you have for meat. The original diet was plant-based diet. Meat eating came in after the flood because the vegetation had been destroyed.
True, preacher.
And it is God's desire that we eat as close as possible to the original diet.
Yes, sir.
Because it's best for us.
Absolutely.
So I was making the point that the Sabbath is not Jewish. The dietary laws are not Jewish.
Jewish.
The speech about alcohol consumption is not Jewish. And I want to repeat to you tonight, don't you know what will kill a Jew?
Yes, sir.
Will also kill you.
Yes. Straight talk, preacher.
There's no difference between a Jew's stomach and mine. Huh? Large intestine, small intestine, opening here, gastric tract, saliva in the mouth, enzymes. It's the same. Human beings are the same. Red or yellow, black or white, we are the same.
Yes, sir.
Are you listening to me? And what's good advice for a Jew? It's good advice for me. And I'm saying to the church, it was given to humanity and not to the Jews.
Amen.
In case you are wondering what I'm really talking about, let me enlighten you as I go forward. The text ends by saying, therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day. Now, this is the commandment, all right? So here tonight, I have already answered this question. Isn't the Sabbath for the Jews only? And the answer is
no.
Here are some biblical passages that you need to hear. I'm reading to you from Revelation chapter 14. And I want you to understand what God is saying the Bible is about. Everybody out loud with the reader, please. Then I saw what?
Another angel.
What is he doing?
Flying in the midst of heaven.
What does he have?
The everlasting gospel.
And what is he going to do?
To preach to
those who are dwelling upon the
earth.
Okay, to every nation.
Yes, sir.
Come on, everybody say nation.
Nation.
Every tribe, say tribe.
Tribe.
Every town.
Town.
Now, town there means language.
Yes, sir.
And if you haven't gotten it yet, the gospel is for every people. White man, black man, Chinese man.
Come on, preacher.
Indian man.
Tut moon.
All man.
Yes, sir.
Does anybody think when I say that it doesn't include women?
Tut moon, preacher, women and men.
So sometimes when you say all men, it means women.
Of
sometimes.
Course. All time.
Yeah. Sometimes. When I say mankind, does it mean womankind? No. All right. No? Let me talk privately. All that dwell on the earth. Thank you very much. Left the other one home. Thank you. So you saw my need. You're a good husband. Not mine, but somebody's.
Amen.
To all them that dwell on the earth, every nation, every tribe, every tongue, every people, the gospel is for everybody.
Yes, sir.
The Bible is for everybody. Jesus is for everybody.
Amen.
And he does not have instructions for one set of people and a different set of instructions for a different set of people. And this means, Brother Gorin, somebody is right and somebody is wrong.
Straight talk.
Now you will decide tonight who is right. What does the angel say?
Fear God.
And do what?
Give glory to him.
Why?
For the hour of his judgment has come.
Together, everybody, let's keep on reading. And do
what? Worship him.
What's the W word, everybody?
Worship him.
Worship who? Worship God. Worship the one who made the heavens. And do you know that the Sabbath is about worship?
Oh, yes.
And here in Revelation, we are told that we must worship the one who did what?
Made
the heavens.
And the earth.
And the earth. The sea.
And the springs.
And the springs of water.
Oh, yes.
How do we worship God as creator? By following his example and keeping the seventh day Sabbath holy.
That's it, preacher.
Am I being clear tonight?
Clear.
Now, what is the basis of human worship? What is the basis of worship? I am again reading from Revelation, this time chapter 4 and verse 11. What does the Bible say, everybody?
You are worthy, O Lord.
To do what?
To receive glory.
And
honor.
And what?
And power.
Why is God worthy to receive glory and honor and power? Because
he created all
you
things.
Created all things.
Yes, sir.
And by your will, they exist and were created.
Yes.
So Revelation 4:11 tells us that the reason why we should worship a God, the reason why we should worship God is because he is creator.
Hallelujah.
So creation and worship belong together.
Yes, sir.
Are you following me, church? Are you buying what I'm selling?
For
now,
sure.
Now, you have to stay with me because I'm doing some teaching tonight. This is a different type of sermon. The Bible says that there is a close relationship between the creator and his creatures contained in worshiping the creator in the way that he has designed. He blessed the seventh day.
Yes, sir.
He sanctified it. He hallowed it. And now he says, 6 days do all your labor and your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. Are you still listening to me?
Yes, preacher.
Now, here we are. Again, at the original commandment. I want to make the point here that these commandments were given after God was already talking about commandments and Sabbath keeping. Let me hurry on to mention that the Sabbath is God's gift to the human race.
Amen.
In Mark chapter 2, verse 27, we are told that the Sabbath was made for who?
Man.
Who is man in this particular verse? Huh?
Man and woman.
People with penises?
Women and men.
The Sabbath was made for who?
Man.
All right. For everybody. Everybody. And that's clear. The Sabbath was made for the benefit of man.
Yes, sir.
Now, when God was creating, the scripture says, he spoke and it was done, he commanded and it stood fast. And there are many statements where God says, let there be, and there was. He began with light. I don't have the time to read all of the creative statements, but he said, let there be light, and there was
light.
And then the Bible keeps on saying, the evening and the morning,
yes, sir,
were the first day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, seventh day. Now, why would the Bible say evening and morning, and not morning and evening. When you read the creation story, you will observe that when God first started to create, there was nothing but darkness in this world. And therefore, the first thing God created was light.
Yes, sir.
He swept away the darkness and created light. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
In order to have a day, you must have a 24-hour period of light and darkness. Are you still listening to me?
For sure.
Darkness alone could not have been the first day. So God said, let there be light. And there was light. And so the dark, the evening, came before the light.
Yes, sir.
The evening came before the morning.
Oh, yes.
And the correct way of reckoning time with God is not midnight.
Come on now.
Midnight was given to us by the Romans.
Oh, yes.
Are you listening to what I'm saying to you? And the calendar that we follow was given to us by the Romans.
True.
But in God's creative order, evening comes before morning.
True, preacher.
And this is why the scripture says the evening and the morning.
Oh, yes.
God reckons time from sunset to sunset, not from midnight.
True.
God does not gather on December 31st and sing, should all acquaintance be forgot?
Come on.
And days of old lang syne. He does not come backwards from 10 to 0 at midnight to start a new day. The new year begins on December 31 at sunset.
Straight talk, preacher.
Are you listening to what I'm saying? Because that's how God reckons time.
Yes, sir.
And this is why on Friday nights, the preacher comes onto the tent and he says to everybody, happy Sabbath.
Amen.
Because Sabbath is not Saturday.
True, true.
Sabbath is Friday night and Saturday. Now, this is the problem that a lot of employers don't understand.
True.
I get lots of letters from employers telling me that as the leader of the church, I can give permission for members of the church to work on Sabbath. Now, I understand that there are other religious leaders who have been seen by others as being capable of changing the rules.
Mercy.
To accommodate people. In the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the pastors cannot change Bible rules.
Amen.
Are you listening to what I'm saying? I cannot give any Seventh-day Adventist permission.
True.
To work on the Sabbath. The Bible says 6 days.
Oh, yes.
Shall you labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it, thou shalt not do any work. And no priest, no bishop, no pope, no pastor, nor be a man.
True talk.
Can change God's word.
Amen, amen.
Are you listening to me tonight? I don't have that authority and that power. Don't give me that authority and power. I am not God. The Seventh-day Adventist pastor makes no claim to have any authority as God.
True.
I cannot forgive sins. Huh? And although I pray for you to be healed, it is God who heals.
Yes, sir.
I have no power. The power belongs to Jehovah.
For sure.
Are you hearing me tonight?
Yes, preacher.
I am a man. Do not pray to me.
True.
Do not worship me.
True.
Do not bow down and do anything to me. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? Because every leader of a church is nothing more, nothing less, and nothing else but a human being representing God.
Amen, preacher.
Are you hearing what I'm not saying? So So we reckon time from sunset to sunset in order to know about the Sabbath. Now watch this. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, God said, what, dear brother Gorin? Let us do what?
Make man in our image.
Uh-huh.
In the image of God.
Created him what?
Male and female.
Now God created who?
Male and female.
How many genders we have nowadays?
Mercy, tell us, preacher.
Now remember, the Bible says in the beginning.
Oh, yes.
And a lot of things have been changed since the beginning, but not by God. God says, in the beginning, I made two.
Yes, sir.
Male and female.
Correct.
Are you listening to what I'm saying?
For sure.
Sometime next week, I believe I have a sermon called I Identify. Be in the house when it comes. I Identify. So God says, let's make man in our own image.
Yes.
And then he made a man and he made a woman.
Yes, sir.
God did not make two men.
Come on now.
God did not make two women.
True.
If he had done that, nobody else would have existed.
True. Come on. True talk.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
The thing that keeps this race taking over,
uh-huh,
is the relationship between the man,
uh-huh,
and the woman.
Correct.
The productivity. In other words, God made us in his image. That is, there's a little bit of creative power in us that looks like the creator.
Yes, sir.
And the way we create is to procreate.
Oh, yeah.
We make children. And only a man and a woman can do that. This is God's order of things. And so God brought the man to the woman and said, for this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave to his wife.
Yes, sir.
The Seventh-day Adventist Church understands that there's no appropriate sexual relationship except between a man and a woman who are married,
yes,
to each other.
Amen.
Any other form of sexual relationship, according to the Bible, is wrong, is immoral, is sinful.
That's the word, preacher.
Not sure what that is, but I hope it is what I said.
Mercy.
Genesis 2, verse 1 to 3. Come on, reader. Everybody with the reader. Does what?
Does the heavens and the earth were finished.
Uh-huh, the creation was done.
And all the host of them.
Because God made man in his own. And then it says, and on the seventh day.
Yes, sir.
So the Sabbath is the final act of God's creation. And he does it not by working, but by resting.
Oh, yes.
Now let me illustrate with Sister Prevost's support that resting is a creative act. Did anybody hear what I just said?
Yes, sir.
Your body does not heal and replenish itself unless you rest and sleep.
True.
Are you hearing what I'm saying to you?
Yes, preacher.
And if you don't sleep, the replacement of vital energies lost, the restoration of cell life, and the promotion of your immune system does not flourish.
True, true.
And therefore, God knew that men and women would need to work.
Yes.
And men and women would need to rest.
Yes, sir.
And the Sabbath gives us the opportunity for rest.
Amen.
Are you hearing me tonight?
Amen, preacher.
It is not only a spiritual thing. If you never thought about it before, Sabbath is a healthful thing.
Amen, amen.
Because if you do not rest, you will burn out. And God, therefore, gave man a period of rest and said to them, remember to rest on the seventh day.
True.
Now, people are saying to me now, Is there a specific day? Yes, but we read it. It says the seventh one.
Yes.
There's only one seventh day in the week. We can come back to that. So God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it. We read that before. Now, the seventh day, therefore, is different from the rest.
Yes.
Because three things were done to it. What was that? God
rested.
God
blessed.
God
sanctified.
Or set apart for holy use. So from the very beginning of time, Adam and Eve had marriage, and they had the Sabbath.
Yes, sir.
And they had an original diet without meat.
True, true.
In the Garden of Eden. This is what they had.
True, preacher.
But man forgot.
Indeed.
We are told that Joseph's family, from the line of Jacob, were slaves in Egypt for at least 400 years.
Yes.
There's another passage in scripture that says 430 years.
Yes.
I have been able to resolve the discrepancy. One author takes the date or the years from the time when they were enslaved. Another author takes the time from when Jacob went down to Egypt before the enslavement. So there's no war. Mm-hmm. 400 years approximately, God's chosen people lived in Egypt. They were slaves.
Yes, sir.
They could not practice their religion as they wanted. They could not worship God on the seventh day Sabbath because their captors made them work.
True, true.
Notice that when God sends Moses to deliver them, the message he gives to Pharaoh is, let my people go, yes, that they may worship me.
Yes, sir.
Have you ever noticed that? So even when God brings them out of slavery, the issue is about worship.
Yes, sir.
In Egypt, they were made to bow down before golden calves. They were made to bow down before images. They were made to worship the Pharaoh. They were made to do all kinds of voodoo and witchcraft and Egyptian sorcery. Remember when Moses went down, that God said to him, throw down your rod, and the thing turned to a serpent. And Pharaoh's men threw down their rods, and God's serpent ate up the serpent of Pharaoh's men, demonstrating that God is the one with the power.
Oh, yes.
Are you hearing me tonight? They were worshiping the Egyptian way. But God said, set them free that they may worship my way. Remember, as they were going across the wilderness, God opened the Red Sea under the leadership of Moses for them to pass. And shortly after he did that, the Bible says the people were hungry. They complained to God, give us something to eat. God opened the heavens and rained down some food from heaven. When they picked it up, the description that is given is that it was a white, flaky-like substance.
Yes, sir.
And they did not know what it was. So they said to each other, what manner of food is this? And the name stuck. And so they called it manna.
Yes,
sir. It would come in the morning.
Yes.
And it would come in the evening.
Oh, yes.
It would come every day. Monday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. And God said to the people, every day, gather what you need for that day. Only for that day. Gather whatever you want. And so they gathered whatever they wanted. But the Bible says, on the sixth day, God said to them, gather twice as much.
Oh, yes.
Because tomorrow, I am going to be resting.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah.
Heaven's bakery is closed on Sabbaths.
Preach it.
But he provides a double portion, yes, on Friday.
Oh, yes.
Did anybody hear me?
Loud.
Should I
clear.
Drive by slowly and shoot straight?
Oh, yes.
Let me repeat that. Heaven's bakery is closed on Sabbath. But God provides a double portion on Friday. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? And this is why Seventh-day Adventists cook their Sabbath meals on Friday.
Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because God says, on the preparation day, the sixth day, gather twice as much.
Right, sir.
Now I hope you 7 days up in here are keeping the commandment.
Come on now.
And I hope that you are making your Sabbath lunches on Friday.
Preach it.
If we are inviting people to be obedient to what God says, we must set the example.
Yes, preacher.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? Seventh-day Adventists earn and prepare their clothing on Fridays. Seventh-day Adventists do not go to work on Sabbaths. Because God says in it, thou shalt not work.
True.
Thou nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant. Nor, are you listening to what I'm saying?
Oh, yes.
I will come to another portion of scripture eventually that will demonstrate where God says there are certain exceptions. But the general principle is no work.
True.
On Sabbath. So Seventh-day Adventists, carpenters, and masons,
yes,
and plumbers, and lawyers,
come on,
do not work on Saturdays.
Amen, preacher.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? Bus drivers.
Come on now.
Do not work on Saturdays. I'm going to say something in here that's going to cause problems. I've warned you. The text says your donkey must rest on the Sabbath. If you have a bus that you use for employment, that is your donkey.
Yes, sir. Steel donkey.
And that donkey must not work.
Yes, sir.
On Sabbath. No, I didn't say it must not drive.
Come on now.
I said it must not work. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because I drive my car.
Yes, sir.
But if this bus is your means of employment, you can't put it to work for money.
True.
On the Sabbath.
Amen.
Y'all don't have to say amen, say ouch. When I said this in Barbados, they wanted to know what planet I came from. I'm still on Earth. Pastor Tittle, this is clear logic. If your hammer and your saw are the tools of your employment, they do not work on Sabbath.
Right.
If your bus, your taxi, your maxi,
come on,
is the tool of your employment, it does not work for hire.
Amen.
On the Sabbath.
Amen, preacher.
I told bus drivers in Barbados, if I pay you to work on Sabbath, I'm going to disfellowship you.
Come on now.
Because you're breaking the Sabbath. I say to them, go to the pump on Friday and fill it. Bring me the bill, I will give you the gas money.
Yes, sir.
And the contribution you make on Sabbath is your offering to the Lord.
Yes, preacher. Come on now.
You should not accept money for it.
True.
Not as payment. And so I am reasonable and fair. So I say to the brethren, I will pay for the diesel. Because it's not free. But I'm not paying you as a Seventh-day Adventist.
True talk.
To drive your bus.
Come on now.
On Sabbath. Then it is your means of employment.
True.
You are not resting.
True.
Now, I know I'm not going to have many friends after that.
But preach
what,
it.
What I told y'all before, I didn't come here for friends.
Good. Preach it.
Think about it. Think about it. Think about it. And know that every believer in Christ is commanded on the Sabbath, thou shalt do no work. And what we do for God on the Sabbath is to support his work, but without pay.
Amen.
Now somebody's going to ask me, Pastor, do you get paid for Sabbath? And I'm going to tell you, I don't know. I have a monthly salary. And I have never asked if it includes, I don't get paid by the day, as far as I know. But I think people who raise that are trying to cop out of the reality. Think about it. Think about it. Now let's go forward. Yeah, let's leave that alone. 6 days you shall gather it. That's what God said about the manna, right? Gather your money, gather your employment, 6 days. But on the seventh day, which is the Sabbath, there will be none.
True.
God did not send them any food from heaven on Sabbath. He told them, gather twice as much on Friday.
Yes, sir.
And then the Bible says some people went out on the Sabbath looking for it.
Mercy.
And they found none. Listen, as Brother Goring reads, as to how God responded to people who went out to pick up food on Sabbath.
How long?
Go ahead.
Do you refuse to keep my commandments?
Wait a minute. God is asking them how long they will refuse to do what?
Keep my commandments. And my laws.
Now, this is strange. Because this is Israel, and the commandments have not yet been written on the tables of stone.
True.
The commandments are written in Exodus 20. And this happens in Exodus 16.
Correct.
And before there's a written commandment, God is already saying to the people, there will be none on Sabbath. How could God be talking about Sabbath when there was no fourth commandment? The answer is, the commandment does not give force and life to the Sabbath.
True.
Creation gives force and life to the Sabbath.
Hallelujah.
And as long as there is a creation, there will be a Sabbath.
Amen.
So go ahead and abolish the commandments. There still will be Sabbath.
Yes, sir.
Because the Sabbath does not come from the commandment. It comes from what God did.
Yes, sir.
The first seventh day of life on earth.
Yes, sir.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Oh, yes.
So you can talk as much as you want about how the commandments are abolished. It does nothing to marriage, because that was in the Garden of Eden. It does nothing to healthful diet, because that was in the Garden of Eden.
True.
It does nothing to the Sabbath, because that was in the Garden of Eden. It does nothing to murder, because Cain was called a murderer before there was a commandment that says, thou shalt not kill.
True.
All of the commandments were in existence before God wrote them down. And the Sabbath is such an important one for him that when he wrote it, he began it with the word, remember. Remember. You only tell people to remember something if you have told them before.
Yes.
A reminder is something that you give a person because you have told them something already.
Yes, sir.
That is simple. And there is enough evidence in the Old Testament to show that before God wrote the commandments on stone, God was already talking about commandments and laws. The seventh day, therefore, is the Sabbath of the Lord our God. It's not the Seventh-day Adventist Sabbath. It's God's Sabbath. In Ezekiel chapter 20 and 12, God tells us why he gave the Sabbath. Read it out loud, please. Moreover,
everybody. I also give them my Sabbath.
Yes.
To be a sign between them.
To be what?
A sign between them and me. That they might know that I am the Lord who sanctifies them.
If we had constantly kept Sabbath from the beginning of the world without forgetting, evolutionary theory will not exist.
True.
Because the Sabbath is a memorial or a memory of how God created the heavens and the earth. It is designed to make us remember who made us.
and to make us worship that person who made us. It is a sign that we belong to God.
Oh, yes.
And those who keep the seventh-day Sabbath have a sign of authority that they are obedient to what God says.
Amen.
So the question tonight, the questions keep coming, Brother Gorin. What's the next question?
What difference does a day make?
Some people say you can worship any day. Why does it have to be the seventh day? I want to let you know that when God says something, it is not optional.
True.
It is not up for debate. Proverbs 14:12 tells us there's a way
which seems right to a man,
but it leads where?
Death.
It leads to death.
Yes.
God's way is the only safe way.
Yes, sir.
In fact, it is the only way, period.
Amen.
Now, clearly, after Adam and Eve had sinned, God gave instructions that lambs were to be killed as sacrifices for sin. He did not ask for okras.
Come on.
Or pumpkins. Or squash. And as much as Dominicans like dashing and green fig. God did not ask for green fig.
True.
He said without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission of sin.
Yes.
Now the issue between Cain and Abel was worship.
Yes, sir.
And some people say it doesn't matter what day you worship on. It matters.
Oh, yes.
Let me show you how I know it matters in more ways than one. God said, bring a lamb.
Yes.
People who tell us the day doesn't matter are suggesting to us that whatever we give God, he must accept.
Mercy.
So if we choose Tuesday, it will be okay with God.
Oh, no.
Does the Bible teach that?
No, sir.
I am reading from Genesis chapter 4, verse 2 to 5. The Bible says, and Abel,
he was a keeper of sheep.
Uh-huh.
But Cain was a tiller of the ground.
Both of them were farmers. One was a pastoral farmer, keeping sheep. And the other one was, what is that now? An arable farmer, raising crops. One had beets and okras and mango and guava. Palm City.
Come on, preacher.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Oh, yes.
I'm going to use every Creole word and nobody tell me finish it.
That's it, preacher.
And say forget some more. Now, hear this. And Abel kept sheep, but Cain had vegetables. And in the process of time, come on, reader.
It came to pass.
What happened?
That Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord.
So Cain brought fruit for God. Is that clear? Did God ask for fruit?
Oh, no.
Did he say Julie Mango?
Oh, no, preacher.
Huh? What did God say he wants? A lamb.
Oh, yeah.
Without spot. Mm-hmm. Or blemish. Or any such thing. You see, the lamb represented Jesus Christ.
Oh, yes.
So he could not be represented by mango.
No, sir.
Not a mango named Julie. Are you listening to what I'm saying? When John the Baptist saw Jesus coming by the river for baptism, he says, behold, the Lamb of God.
Oh, yes.
Because Jesus is the Lamb of God. So let's go back. Abel brought what? Sheep. But Cain brought what? Fruit. And Cain brought fruit as an offering to God. The issue was worship.
Yes, sir.
The next verse says what, reader?
And Abel also brought of the firstlings of his flock.
That means he brought sheep.
And of the fat thereof.
Because that's what God asked for. And the Lord
had respect
unto who?
Abel.
What did Abel bring? Come on, everybody, you're reading with me. What did Abel bring? He brought a lamb. And the Bible says God had respect, acceptance,
oh, yes,
favor,
oh, yes,
blessing, compliments, commendations for Abel.
For sure.
And to his offering. But on to Cain.
And to his offering.
The Lord had no respect.
True, preacher.
This story alone by itself, without anything else, tells us God will not accept any and everything.
True. Straight talk, preacher. Say it again, preacher.
It does not matter how good your intentions are.
Yes, sir.
If God says a lamb, it's a lamb.
Amen.
If God says a seventh day, it cannot be the fifth.
True.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Human beings are not allowed to substitute their thinking.
True.
For what God says. And I don't care what year it is or how modern we have become. I will never accept that human beings have the right to change God's laws.
Amen. Amen.
There are churches where the religious leaders have changed the rules. One by one, nowadays, churches are saying, we accept. We accept. Mm-hmm. We accept. It is a modern age, they say. It's 2024. We are no longer in the dark ages. People have human rights. Are you listening to what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
People have the right to obey God. That's how I see it. That's how I see it. And God says, seventh day. He means seventh day.
Amen.
Are you hearing me tonight? So Cain became a murderer. Instead of humbling himself and asking his brother, can I have a lamb? I will give you something to eat, vegetables to put on your plate. But I need to bring a lamb. Instead of humbling himself, he killed his brother. Became a vagabond in the earth. I want to say to you tonight, Jesus was a Sabbath keeper.
Hallelujah.
Are you hearing me, church? Taking my time and I'm going a bit slow. You have to get it. I'm not going to keep you too long, but you have got to get it. Jesus kept what day?
The Bible Sabbath.
How do I know? Luke chapter 4 and verse 16. This is a very important passage. Write it down and read it when you get home. The Bible says in Luke 4 and verse 16, and he, Jesus, it's talking about Jesus, came to Nazareth where he had been brought up.
Oh, yes.
And as his, say the C word, everybody.
Custom was.
The C word, that's on the screen. Say that C word for me, please.
Custom.
As his custom was. Now, what is a custom? A custom is a habit.
Oh, yes.
Pastor Tito. And you know that habit is spelled H-A-B-I-T.
Yes, sir.
Habits are hard to get rid of. Because if you get rid of the H, you still have a bit.
A bit of it. Okay, preacher.
And if you get rid of the A, come you on. Still have bit.
Come on now.
And if you get rid of the B, you still have it.
Oh, yes.
Habits are hard to break. And the Bible says Jesus had a custom. He was accustomed to going to the synagogue on the Sabbath day. Now, the equivalent of modern churches is the synagogue in Jesus' time.
Yes, sir.
Somebody said recently, Jesus never went in a building for worship. He was on the outside. But the reality is, my Bible says, he went, but his custom was, he went into the what?
Synagogue.
When?
On the Sabbath day.
On the Sabbath day. And he stood up to read.
Yes, sir.
He read from the Old Testament.
For sure.
Because there was no New Testament. Jesus was an Old Testament preacher.
Oh, yes.
And there are pastors all over the world today telling people the Old Testament abolish. Don't preach from it. Don't teach any doctrine from it. It's just New Testament. But Jesus was an Old Testament preacher. When Jesus went to church, he read from the book of Isaiah, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. That's Isaiah 66, I believe.
Yes, sir.
Jesus read from it. And when Satan tackled him in the wilderness, all these things will I give to you. He quoted from the Old Testament.
Oh, yes.
He quoted and said, thou shalt worship God only, and him only shalt thou serve.
True.
Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written.
Oh, yes.
And he quoted the Old Testament. I want to be like Jesus.
Oh, yes.
So I quote in the Old Testament. Leave Hall alone. Don't tell me anything about how the New Testament is the only valid scriptures. That is not true. The Apostle Paul says all scripture and all the scripture that Paul had was the Old Testament. So Jesus went to church on the Sabbath and read from the Old Testament. Now, this same Jesus says, if you love me, what are you going to do?
Keep my commandment.
So he was speaking to the disciples. And he told them, I am going to die. And various things will happen. Signs and so on. Matthew 24. And they said to him, when shall these things be?
Oh, yes.
And what shall be the signs of your coming? Jesus told them, Jerusalem is going to be destroyed. That is going to be a sign that you need to run. And then he says to them in verse 20.
Yes.
What does he say there?
But pray ye.
That your what?
Flight be not in the winter.
Now he wasn't talking about Liat or Caribbean Airlines.
No, sir.
Although perhaps you should avoid traveling on Sabbath.
True.
It comes with a lot of challenges to Sabbath observance. But watch this. Where was I? But pray that your flight be not in the winter.
Yes, sir.
Or on the what?
Sabbath day.
Jesus was telling his disciples, when Jerusalem is destroyed and you have to run, pray that that does not happen on a Sabbath day. Now, why would Jesus tell them that if he had planned to abolish the Sabbath?
True.
Jerusalem was surrounded by the Roman armies and destroyed by Titus. In what year, reader?
AD 70.
Jesus was already dead, resurrected, and gone back to heaven when this occurred.
True.
But yet he predicted that when this happened, people would still be keeping the Sabbath. If Jesus was abolishing the Sabbath, would he not have told his disciples?
For sure.
Clearly, the apostles didn't know anything about it.
True.
Because the New Testament church, led by Paul and Peter and James and John and the others,
yes,
they kept the Bible Seventh-day Sabbath.
Yes, sir.
The disciples loved and obeyed Jesus. And if he had abolished it, certainly Paul would have known. In Acts chapter 13 and verse 14, we see an example of them keeping the Sabbath. What does it say, reader?
They went into the synagogue
on the what?
Sabbath day.
Uh-huh.
And sat down.
And sat down. The Gentiles begged them. That Sabbath Paul preached. And then it says in verse 42 and 44, the Gentiles begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath.
True.
So wait a minute. People say that the Sabbath was for the Jews. But this passage here is talking about Gentiles.
Oh, yes.
Now, I think many of you read the Bible too fast. Slow down. And look carefully at the words. The Gentiles were in church the Sabbath when Paul preached. And they begged.
Yes, sir.
That these words might be preached to them again.
The next Sabbath.
It was so sweet, they wanted more.
Oh, yes.
They wanted more. On the next Sabbath.
Yes.
Almost the whole city came together. Tomorrow morning, let all of Dominica.
Yes, sir.
Come together.
Yes, preacher.
I really don't want you on Zoom. I don't want you on YouTube, Dominica. Leave that for the Bajans. Leave that for the Bajans and the St. Lucians and the Vincies. If you are in Dominica, the whole city.
Yes, sir.
The word of God will be preached on the Sabbath day.
Hallelujah.
So let's go. I'm getting there. And then Acts 16, 13. And on the Sabbath day, this is in another city, there was no synagogue in this city. So they went out in the open to have church. Let me drop a word here. There are some Seventh-day Adventists telling me that to worship outdoors is not worship. Mm. But Jesus sat down on the Mount of Olives.
Oh, yes.
Huh? I suspect he didn't have a good suit. Because to sit on the Mount of Olives and teach people, you can't wear a good suit.
True.
Or to sit in Peter's boat. Let me tell you something, man. Jesus taught in the synagogue, taught outdoors. Churches assembled both in and out. And they sat by the riverside. Now watch this. On the Sabbath day, there was no synagogue. We went out of the city to the riverside. Finish it, reader.
Where prayer was customarily made.
And they had a custom of doing it too because they didn't have any synagogue in that city. Huh?
True.
Watch this. And then the Bible says about Paul, Acts 18. Yes. And he reasoned.
Reasoned.
Where?
In the synagogue.
In another city now.
Every Sabbath, preacher.
And persuaded both
Jews and Greeks.
Now, do you see it there? Which tells me Paul was offering the Sabbath to people who were not Jews.
True.
Which lets me know that Paul understood that the Sabbath was not simply for the Jews.
True.
Whosoever will may come. Now, the Bible's last book calls us to obey God.
Yes, sir.
In Revelation chapter 14, verse 12, what do we read, everybody? Out loud.
Here is the patience of the saints.
Here are they
that keep the commandments of God.
And have what?
The faith of Jesus.
The Bible says that the people who are going to be saved will have the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I don't have the time to discuss it tonight, but you'll hear about it soon. The faith of Jesus is also called the spirit of prophecy. And that spirit of prophecy includes every prophet who has ever lived and everyone whom the Lord will send.
Yes, sir.
The Seventh-day Adventist Church has a prophetess.
Amen.
That is the spirit of prophecy. So the people who are saved keep the commandments of God. And they have the faith of Jesus, which is also called the spirit of prophecy.
Yes, preacher.
I'm getting there, reader. Let's go. The book of Isaiah tells us that Sabbath will be kept in heaven.
Oh, yes.
Let's read it out loud. Isaiah 66, 22 and 23.
For as the new heavens.
Can I get everybody reading with the reader, please?
For
everybody.
As the new heavens and the new earth.
Which I will. Go ahead.
Shall remain before me, says the Lord. So shall your descendants and your name remain.
Now, where are we going to have a new heaven and a new earth? When is that going to be? When God recreates everything, right? What we call heaven at last. And the Bible says, in that day, now go ahead.
From one new moon to another.
And from what?
Sabbath.
Stop there. And from what?
Sabbath.
One Sabbath. To another.
Yes, sir.
What's going to happen?
All flesh
shall come to worship
before me, says the Lord.
So here's a passage that says in heaven, God is going to have Sabbath school and divine hour.
Come on, preacher.
Are you listening to me?
Oh, yes.
Now watch this. I would think that if the seventh day Sabbath is going to be kept in heaven, it makes sense to practice it here and now.
Amen. Absolutely.
For those who are going to heaven.
Yes.
Keep the commandments. And have the faith
of Jesus Christ.
Now how can we be sure which day is the seventh day? I would like to offer $500. To the person who comes to me at 7 a.m. on the seventh day of the week. You just have to come and collect it, and I will offer the $500 to you. Now, if I said that, anybody coming on Sunday?
Oh, no.
If, now, we should not gamble, but as an illustration, let's say you won $1 million lotto. And the people sent out and told you, come for the money.
Okay, preacher.
On the third day of the week.
Okay.
What day are you going? Huh? What day are you going? Sunday.
Oh, yes.
Monday.
Uh-huh.
Tuesday.
For sure.
Is anybody gonna say any day will do?
Oh, no.
So why are we doing that with God? Why are we doing that with God? God says the seventh day. Tradition says any day will do. Tradition says we know better than God. God commanded that the seventh day be kept as a Sabbath. Tradition says we will keep the first day in honor of the resurrection. God did not ask for that.
True.
He asked for the seventh day. Nowhere in scripture do you see any command to honor the resurrection.
True.
You see a command to honor the creation.
Oh, yes.
And the creator, the seventh day. It's the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. So how can we know which day is the seventh day? I'm going to read for you from the Bible. But first I have to establish something with you. Everybody in Christendom, generally speaking, agrees that Jesus was crucified on a Friday.
True.
And that he rose from the grave on a Sunday.
For sure.
Are we in agreement with that?
Yes, preacher.
Just last weekend, we celebrated that.
True.
Don't pretend with me up in here tonight. We celebrated that last week. Christianity acknowledges that the day on which Jesus died was Friday. We call it Good Friday. And we say that he got up on the first day of the week. True. What do we call that?
Easter Sunday. Yes, preacher.
Now let's read the Bible. We are reading from the New Testament book of Luke, chapter 23. And we are going to go straight into the first verse of 24 without breaking. Let's read the Bible. Since we agree,
yes,
that Jesus died on Friday and rose on Sunday, let's read the Bible.
Yes, preacher.
The Bible says that the day on which Jesus died, I'm reading from Luke. Luke says that day, come on, reader.
Was the preparation.
Stop. The preparation for what? The preparation for the Sabbath.
Oh, yes.
Because remember, Jesus said, pick up twice as much. Prepare yourself on the sixth day.
True.
For the Sabbath.
Yes.
So Luke says, this is the same story that we celebrated last weekend. Luke says that the day on which Jesus died was the preparation. Read now, reader.
And the Sabbath drew near.
All right, let's read the Bible. If that day was the preparation and the Sabbath drew near, what is he saying? He is saying that Jesus died in the afternoon towards evening of the day before the Sabbath.
Yes, preacher.
Isn't that obvious and clear?
Clear.
We have already said that the Sabbath begins at sunset.
True.
And therefore, if Jesus died, and there's evidence for this, the crucifixion was somewhere around 3 p.m. in the afternoon when Jesus died.
Yes.
Because that was the hour when the afternoon lamb was killed at the temple.
Yes.
And that was the same time that the veil was torn from top to bottom and the lamb got away because the Lamb of God had died.
Yes, preacher.
Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
They left his body upon the cross for a while and they took it down. But the Sabbath was coming. That's what Luke says, not so?
Yes, preacher.
All right, let's continue. Let's read that again. That day was the
preparation,
and the Sabbath
drew near,
was coming. Now go on.
And the women who had come with him from Galilee,
who were those? Mary, Martha, Magdalene, and other women.
Yes.
They had come with him from Galilee. What does it say about the women? They followed after. Continue.
And they observed the tomb and how his body was laid.
And which day does the Bible call this? The preparation.
Yes, preacher.
Preparation day. Then.
Yes.
They returned.
Yes.
And prepared spices and fragrant oils. That means they went home.
Yes.
And they prepared the anointing oils. Now read the next verse, elder.
And they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment.
Now, is that clear to everybody? They rested on the Sabbath according to what? So wait a minute. Jesus died on Friday. And Sabbath was coming. That's what Luke says. The women went home and prepared spices and ointments because it was now too close to Sabbath for them to do work. And so they rested on the Sabbath day and read the final words according to the
commandment.
Now, which day does the commandment say you should rest?
The seventh day, preacher.
And they rested according to the
commandment.
So they rested when? On the
Sabbath.
Seventh day.
Yes, 7 days.
Is that logical and clear from scripture?
Crystal.
Now, let's keep on reading. Now, we go to chapter 24, verse 1. Right?
Yes, preacher.
And that very next verse says, now,
on
the first day of the week.
Yes, preacher.
Very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb.
Oh, yes.
Bringing the spices they had prepared. But they found that the stone was rolled away.
Yes, preacher.
From the tomb.
Oh, yes.
He arose.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Christ arose. And we celebrated it last week. The preparation day is Good Friday. The day on which he rose is Easter Sunday. The Bible calls Friday preparation.
Yes.
It calls Easter Sunday first day of the week.
Yes.
And it calls the day between those two the Sabbath.
Amen.
That's the Bible.
That's the word, preacher.
The Bible defines for us through the story that we call the Easter story, which day is the Sabbath.
Crystal.
All of us agree he died Friday and got up Sunday.
Oh, yes.
And Luke says the day in between.
In between.
Was the seventh day Sabbath.
Hallelujah.
According to the commandment.
Yes, preacher.
Dominicans, answer me in one word. Which day is between Friday and Sunday? Which day is the Sabbath? Saturday. It's not rocket science. It's simple. Anybody who does not see this, Barry, does not want to see it. And I don't want to offend anybody, but such people are deceitful.
Straight talk, preacher.
They prefer the traditions of man to the word of God.
Mercy.
The word of God says seventh day, and we just proved that from the Bible. We are talking about Saturday. Now, I got to finish this. So the preparation day is Friday. The Sabbath day is Saturday.
Yes, sir.
And the first day of the week is Sunday.
Crystal.
Any basic dictionary will tell you that the seventh day is Saturday.
Yes, preacher.
And anybody who argues against that, just like noise. Because this is easy and simple to see. And I told you on Sunday night, if people read the Bible honestly, there would be one conclusion.
Yes, preacher.
I am a Seventh-day Adventist because reading the Bible leads me to see.
Yes.
That the things this church teaches is most closely aligned with Scripture.
Yes.
And we don't want the traditions. We want the Scriptures.
Amen.
And any prophet or prophetess that comes along and this church acknowledges there will be prophets. But the prophet must conform with Scripture.
Oh, yes.
To the word and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this, there is no light.
No light.
So I embrace Ellen White as a prophetess because I see her.
Oh, yes.
Aligned with Scripture. It will take some time for you to see. But I have tested her. I have tested her. In over 105 languages, the word for a seventh day of the week is Sabbath.
Yes, sir.
In Arabic, it's Sabbath. Now, I don't know if I'm pronouncing them correctly, but I'm a researcher. I like to read. All you need to read more.
Yes, sir.
In Armenian, Shabbat.
Yes.
In Bosnian, Subota. In Croatian, Subota. In Czech, Sobota. In Greek, Sabato. In Italian, Sabato. In Latin, Sabbatum. In French, aha. Aha, Dominica. In Polish, Sabota. In Portuguese, Sabato. In Romanian, Sambata. In Russian, Suboto. Subota. In Serbian, Subota. In Samaria, Sabti. In Spanish, Sabado. In Bajan, Sada.
Okay, Pastor.
Bajan's fine. It takes so much time to say a Saturday. We say a Sada. Some of the old people say a Sadi. Sadi. Sada. Saturday. It is clear that
Amen.
Saturday is the seventh day of the week.
Yes, sir.
There are a few European calendars that have tried to change it now to have Monday be the first day of the week. And they are doing that so that Sunday becomes the seventh. You all understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
They're trying to manufacture something now.
Yes.
But we have always had calendars that showed us Sunday is the first day.
Yes, sir.
And Saturday is the seventh.
Oh, yes.
And even the tradition of celebrating Easter is against those who claim that Sunday is the Sabbath.
True.
Now, I told you tonight is a big one. It's going to be hard. I don't always talk like this, but this one has to come straight. Jesus is saying tonight, if you love me,
keep my commandments.
And in James 2:10, there is a shocker. James 2:10 says, but reader, what does that say?
For whosoever shall keep the whole law.
Stop. We know 10, right? So if you say, thou shalt have no other gods before me, thou shalt not make any graven images, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, and then you go to honor your father and your mother, don't kill. Don't steal. Don't lie. Do not covet. I miss one in there. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. If you keep 9 and break 1.
Yes.
What does this text say?
He is guilty of all.
So let me illustrate. Pastor Tittle. I don't know what the tallest building is in Dominica. You know the tallest in Antigua? Huh? But let's say that you are on top of the Empire State Building or the Statue of Liberty or something like that. And you are fastened onto something by 10 links of chain. You are tied on and holding on to these 10 links of chain. Would it be okay to remove the fourth? Would it be okay to remove the fourth and say, I got nine? Would you say the fourth link of chain is for the Jews?
Oh, no.
This is not logical.
True.
The Ten Commandments, they are one body of law.
Oh, yes, preacher.
And if we say the fourth is Jewish, we have to say all are Jewish.
Go ahead.
And if they are Jewish, we can lie. We can steal. We can commit adultery.
Mercy.
Because all the commandments are for the Jews. But we cannot pick and choose which one we want to give to the Jews and which ones we want to give to the Gentiles. My Bible says the law of the Lord is perfect.
Yes, preacher.
There is nothing wrong with the ten. All of them are correct. Oh. All of them are true. And James says, if you keep all but offending one, you are guilty of all.
That's the word, preacher.
And let me tell you all, Seventh-day Adventists, how that works. If you keep the Sabbath and you're sleeping with somebody, woman,
come on,
you're still going to hell.
Go ahead now, preacher. Straight talk. Come on, preacher.
If you keep in the Sabbath and you're lying,
come on,
through your teeth, your hell is going to be hot.
Hot, preacher.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
My Bible says you must have coverage for all.
All.
And I want to remind Seventh-day Adventists, you're not better than anybody else.
True. True, preacher.
Sabbath does not make you better.
True.
What makes us acceptable to God is when we dedicate all to Him.
Yes, sir.
Everything. So do not rest on the Sabbath as though it is the ticket to heaven. We've got to obey all law. And anybody tonight whose life is not lined up with the ten needs to get right with God.
Yes, sir.
And do it now. 1 John 2:4, what does that say, reader?
He who says, I know him.
And does not keep the?
His commandments.
Is a what?
Liar.
And the truth is?
Not in him.
Praise team, come. We're going to close this meeting. I have one more text to read for you tonight. Reader, I'm going to take this one. I got a last text. Are you ready for my final text?
Oh, yes, preacher.
My final text comes from Galatians 4:16. Am I therefore become your enemy? Because I told you the truth? Everybody jumps up and celebrates when I speak about how God is going to bless you, how He's going to help you, how He's going to change you. Jump up and celebrate. Now, when I tell you also, the commandments must be kept. We're getting ready to close. It seems like I caught the praise team off guard.
They're here, preacher. They're here.
Yeah, I gotta close. Time to close. My call tonight is simple. Say if you do not pass me by, you know the one we're gonna sing. You can take back the screen from me. I'm done. Am I now become your enemy because I told you the truth? The truth will save you, but it will hurt you first. But the songwriter says, come every soul by sin oppressed. There's mercy with the Lord. Come boldly to the throne of grace and find help. in a time of need. Perhaps you did not know before, in case you missed it, I thought I would mention it tonight. Saturday is the Bible Sabbath. And I'm asking tonight, who is going to make a commitment? And this is a call for everybody. Who is going to make a commitment tonight? I will honor God's Sabbath. Stand with me to your feet. Let's sing the song. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, while you are standing. If you're going to make that commitment tonight. As I said, I'm calling everybody. I'm not drawing any distinctions between members and non-members. Everybody, this first call is for you. You know how we do it? Every night we add a truth. We pray about that truth. Thank you, my brother. And while on the first thou art, do not pass me by. Come. If you're gonna be with God tonight in obedience, come. From the back tent. This call is for you as well. Every night when I call, it's for both tents. If you want to say tonight, God, I will be obedient. Come on down to the altar. Come on down to the altar. Elders, members, pastors, encourage those in the back tent to come to the altar. This call is for you. Let me at thy throne of mercy. Do not stay away from God. We do not have a platform in the back tent. The platform is up here. The point of appeal is up here. The preacher is up here. Come to Jesus. Wherever you are, standing around in the yard, Jesus is calling. Help my unbelief. Everybody sing, Savior.
Savior.
Hear my cry.
Hear my
humble cry. And while on others thou art called. Somebody else in the back tent needs to come. Do not pass me.
I want to say especially to members gathered in that yellow and white tent. You are at the campaign for homes of hope and healing. The back tent is not a place to become withdrawn and isolated from what is happening. All of us are at worship here every night. And the business for which we have come is to persuade and compel men and women to follow the word of God. And when the call is made, as long as you are inside these gates, that call is for you. I'm asking my members to set an example for the visitors. And when the call is made, come to the altar. Do not hide in that yellow and white tent. Do not hide in that yellow and white tent. We have put it there so you can be comfortably seated. But when the call, the action is up here. Encourage your friend, your neighbor, to come to the altar for prayer. Come forward. Pastor Moranci, we might have to take down that tent. Move the furniture inside this one. Come on, members. Your leader is talking to you. I'm not God, but I'm your leader. And I'm asking you to come here for the right reasons. Get involved. Get involved. Get involved. Get involved. Get involved. Hallelujah tonight. I have but one more call. You know where I'm going. The baptism has been set for tomorrow.
the brighter side of the Sabbath. I am inviting all of you to be present, because in the morning, as tonight, it is the seventh day Sabbath. Don't go to work. Come to worship God. Do not seek your own pleasure. Come to worship God. Some of you have decided that you are going to align your life with the truth. Every time I preach, it is to call people to align themselves with what the Bible says. There's no other point. There's no other reason for the preaching and teaching. If you have discovered that you were not doing it right and you now see a new way, God is telling you this is the way. Walk in it. Some of you were baptized last Sabbath. I'm glad to see some of you here. If you were baptized last Sabbath, I would like you to come and stand on this platform as a witness that you last Sabbath gave your life to Jesus Christ. Are you here? You were baptized? I know. Come, my sister. Even if it's me and you. Who else? Other people were baptized last Sabbath. I know it's a little intimidating, but I'm going to stand next to you. In fact, stand behind me. I'm protecting you. Come, my sister. You were baptized last Sabbath? Praise God. Praise God. You look like her. She looks like you. Welcome. Who else was baptized last Sabbath? Come, my brother. We've got to keep them close. These are people who made up their minds and went down to baptism last Sabbath. Others of you are ready for tomorrow. You are ready for tomorrow. If you're ready, give me your hand. Give me your hand. Come on up. Come on up. Let everybody see. Give me your hand. Give Jesus your heart. Your hand and your heart. All the children of Adventist parents need to come. Give me your hand, my brother. God bless you. God bless you. Who else is coming? God. All those who are ready, come. You're ready? If you're ready, come. Give me your hand. It's not that hard. I know. Come. And you're going to get a little extra. Come. God bless you. Been praying for you, girl. Come, son. Come. Who else is coming tonight? My sweetheart, is it your time? Come. Who's walking with you? Who else? Who else is coming? Who else is coming? Do not put this off. I was in a campaign in Barbados. Wendell Hinkson, to the best of my knowledge, from Barbados, was in that campaign as well. The campaign was preached by a pastor called Easton Marks. Listen to what I'm saying as you come. Those who are coming, come. On a Friday night like this, if you're in the back tent, come please. Come. Come. Praise God. Come on up. Come on up. Keep coming. And this is not all. The Lord has told me. The Lord has spoken to me. I know them all. The Lord has spoken to me. I'm claiming it. Now listen to me, members. Are you listening? Listen carefully to me. I'm going to call him Rodney. That's not his real name. It was a night like this. I believe it was a Wednesday night. And myself and the leader spoke to Rodney. We said, Rodney, give your life to Jesus. You don't have time. The devil makes you feel that you have time. He wants you to delay and put it off. And then just like that, he takes your life. I said, Rodney, give your life to Jesus. He said, Pastor, one more dance. One more dance. His problem is that he saw the truth. He knew it to be truth, but he wanted one last disco. I'm an old man, so I know disco. Instead of coming to the tent Friday night, Pastor Morancy, he went into the dance hall. And you know how people like to do it? He's holding close with somebody else's woman. and grinding in a corner of the dark room. Give me your hand, my love. Give Jesus your heart. Is there somebody else? Rodney is holding on. He's whining and grinding. Pardon my expression. I like to be animated. I like to illustrate what I'm talking about. And while he's there rubbing upon this girl, not his, somebody else's girl, the man came into the dance. Pushed the scissors in his gut 17 times. He bled out and died in the dance hall. But he was correct. One last dance. What is keeping you tonight? What is it that is keeping you? Why are you holding back? Why aren't you coming forward? Why aren't you surrendering to Jesus? What are you saying, Pastor? Not tomorrow, some other time, some other day, a more convenient season. There is no more convenient season. It is a trick of the devil for you to delay. Then he finds a way to get you. I'm appealing to all you Seventh-day Adventists who used to love the Lord, who are backslidden and have turned away from serving God. Come back to Jesus. Online, be at this time tomorrow. Jesus is calling you. Jesus is calling you. Fill that form out. If you have a child, Adventist parent, 7, 8, 9, 10 years old, who needs to be baptized, ensure that you speak to them tonight and tomorrow and bring them to the tent. All you Adventist children, talk to your parents. Say, Mommy, I'm ready. Daddy, I'm ready. The Bible says, suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. What is keeping you tonight? Is there one more person tonight? Give me your hand. Is there one more in here tonight? Would you give me your hand? And give Jesus your heart. The Spirit says, Hall, walk to the back tent. Excuse me. Cameraman, you're going to have trouble. Praise team, sing a stanza for us, please. Trusting only in thy merit.
Trusting only in thy merit.
There's somebody over here who needs to make a decision for Jesus Christ. Who needs to come to the altar and give it up tonight. Is it your time? Will you speak tonight? Somebody in here tonight who will give me their hand and give Jesus their heart. Have you been to Jesus? Talk to your mommy. Talk to your daddy. Who else is coming? Sir, is it your thing? Is Jesus calling you tonight? Would you give me your hand? Would you give me your hand? Is it your time? Won't you give Jesus a chance in your life tonight? You didn't come here expecting, but Christ is calling you. Won't you surrender tonight? Won't you give him a chance tonight? Give me your hand, somebody. I'll walk with you. I'll walk with you. Talk to your friend. Talk to your neighbor. Say a prayer with them, a prayer for them. Somebody else needs to come. One more person tonight. There's another stanza, praise team. That last stanza. Sing it, sing it. Somebody else is coming. Won't you give Jesus a chance tonight? Won't you surrender him tonight? Heal my wounded, broken spirit. On earth beside thee, who in heaven but thee? Somebody else tonight for Jesus. Just step onto the platform. Sing Savior for the last time. Somebody sing Savior. Savior, hear my humble, my cry. Would you surrender to Jesus tonight? Would you give him a chance in your life? Give me your hand and give Jesus your heart. Is there somebody else tonight? Is there somebody else in here tonight who will give Jesus a chance?
hear my humble cry.
And why?
Praise God tonight. I know there are other people here. And the Spirit of God has told me you will be in the water tomorrow. I am praying for it. And God has promised me that His word will not return void. There are many others who need to come. Please, do not run away from God. Surrender. Submit. Submit, my sister. Submit, my brother. Submit. Heavenly Father, tonight, we thank you for the Sabbath truth and for all the other truths that have been preached under this tent. We know that your Holy Spirit has been speaking to our hearts. Father, in the name of Jesus, and by the stately steppings of your Holy Spirit, move up and down this place, Lord, and deliver men and women. Lord, heal people. Save people. Rescue people. Snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Lord, we're going to weep all the erring ones and patiently win them. Tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save. Tonight, oh God, thank you for those who have come and surrendered their lives. Lord, seal them by your Holy Spirit. There are others who my heart prays for tonight. Lord, bring them also against the brighter side of this Sabbath, Lord. Persuade, convince, give them no rest, Holy Spirit, until they come to the foot of the cross crying, I yield, I yield. I can no longer hold out. We give you honor, glory, and praise, and thanks for the wonderful God that you are. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please get home safely. Bible workers, ensure that everybody on the platform has a card and that you talk and pray with them before they go. Get home safely. Tomorrow's topic will be walking with Jesus. We begin at 9 a.m. After the service, around midday, the baptism happens. And at 3:45, we will have that concert. Let us sing the departure song.